the crossing analyses of the IT industry and international relations. Welcome to the Tech Geopolitics Unveiled. I'm Rocky Uriankai. Today's topic is a question raised by one of our loyal viewers in the comment section. They want me to interpret the content of Huawei Connect 2023, held on September 20th, and analyze what technical difficulties or challenges this blueprint will encounter. This question happens to fit the main theme of our show, as it's a topic involving international relations and technology industries that's worth digging deep into. Okay, enough talk. Let's begin. The full text of Meng Wanzhou's speech that day was published on Baidu. It has about 3,500 words. I've read through it a few times and discovered it has a major hidden message. We can compare it to the technical highlights of Huawei's Mate 60 series of smartphones, which was quietly launched 3 weeks before the event at the end of August. I believe that Huawei itself, do note that this is referring to Huawei itself and not SMIC, which is almost universally recognized as the company that mass-produced the Kirin 9000S chip for Huawei. Huawei itself has made a major breakthrough in wafer manufacturing technology. My arguments are as follows. Meng Wanzhou, representing Huawei, reviewed the company's major strategy of the past decade. In 2023, the focus is on all IP, which means comprehensively promoting various knowledge, technical expertise, and protocols in the communication field. Huawei has moved from diverse standards to a unified approach. This move was in response to the development opportunities Huawei faced back in 2013. Despite the burst of the internet bubble back then, the momentum of the internet was unstoppable. Huawei has a foundation in the communication technology, CT sector, so it made sense to combine it with information technology, IT. The results, in Meng Wanzhou's exact words that day, were that it promoted the ubiquity of connectivity, which is not an exaggeration. What was Huawei's major strategy in 2013? Every decade has a major strategy, and in 2013 it was all cloud, with the goal of accelerating the upgrade of digital transformation. In 2017, Huawei further clarified its strategic goal to become one of the world's top five clouds, which means it wanted to be one of the five major cloud service providers globally. Huawei claims that it has already achieved this goal, but I have reservations about this. Viewers can look up the rankings of the world's top 10 cloud service providers. At least in mainland China, I think Alibaba Cloud is the largest cloud service provider. Feel free to correct me if I'm wrong. This may be related to the US sanctions that started in 2019, but I'm not sure. However, this is not the focus today and can be left aside. Returning to the main topic today, in 2023, Huawei announced its major strategy as all intelligence. Meng Wanzhou's speech immediately explained the meaning of all intelligence, comprehensive smartification to seize strategic opportunities together and accelerate the industry's smartification. Another sentence is, the strategic goal is to accelerate the smart transformation of thousands of industries. These are her original words. She also listed three separate points to further illustrate this. Here's my summary of these three points. The first is for all targets to be connectable. The second is for all applications to be modeled. The third is for all decisions to be calculated. Pay attention here. It's this third point that has got me thinking, or you can say that my mind has been blown. What is my question? Meng also emphasized the need to utilize the omnipotence of computing power to accelerate the omnipresence of intelligence, allowing data to continuously unleash its potential through computing power. These are all her original words. Computing power requires a large number of high-end advanced manufacturing process technology logic chips to complete. When we look at Huawei, it has its chip design subsidiary HiSilicon, so the design won't be an issue. As for the EDA tools required for the design process, I recall that Huawei's rotating chairman, Eric Xu, announced on February 28th this year that they can now self-develop EDA tools. They've already done 28 no-mouse, and they're going to advance this part further. My rough understanding, the upper level of the IC circuit design is not too difficult. It doesn't matter how many nanometers, the difference is not significant. However, the lower level is related to the process and it's best to coordinate with a fab. For instance, Taiwan has TSMC, so EDA software tools can be advanced to processes such as 7nm, 5nm and 3nm. EDA tools providers and IC design houses will discuss with foundries like TSMC so everyone can proceed together. However, Huawei's Mate 60 phone uses the Kirin 9000S, which has a chip that is obviously using an advanced process, as the chip is close to 7nm. With US sanctions cutting off EDA supply to Huawei, where did its EDA tools come from? It seems that they've also made a breakthrough in EDA tools, something I talked about in previous episodes. Regardless, the most crucial point is that after designing, you need to manufacture it. Moreover, for it to be considered mass production, it needs to be able to make millions or even billions of chips. The fact that Huawei dared to announce this in public, even making it a key point in Meng Wanzhou's speech, almost like a slogan, that Huawei aims to build a robust computing power foundation for China and, in turn, provide the world with a second option. Wow, that's quite ambitious. Maybe when she said world, she didn't mean the earth, but the world of technology. However, China is very clearly a country, right? A country with a vast population of 1.4 billion people. This isn't just for Huawei itself. It's about building a computing power foundation for China. If Huawei doesn't have the capability to mass produce advanced logic chips with sufficient quality, where will this computing power come from? Of course, you can argue that this is a strategic goal for the next decade, not something to be achieved overnight. But if this Huawei Connect 2023 event was presented independently by Huawei, I would probably perceive it as just having ambitious aspirations. It's like in primary school when many classmates would write about their dreams of becoming the president. Some even wrote that they wanted to be President Chiang. Can't really laugh at them, though, since throughout their lives they only knew presidents with the last name Chiang.
Well, back to the topic. My question is, does Huawei already have this kind of chip that can be the so-called foundation for computing power? It appears that they indeed do, because at the end of her speech it first mentioned Kunpeng and then Ascend. Both have official websites. Additionally, these two are referred to as sectors.
Not just a single chip or chipset. It's a little hint that it wants to become an ecosystem. So now my question is, if Huawei wants to be the computing power foundation for China, Kunpeng and Ascend chips need to be mass-produced at the scale of billions of units. If Huawei wants to do this over the next decade, under the prerequisite that US sanctions are unlikely to ease up over the next 10 years, they need to have the capability. So, all the advanced equipment required in the advanced chip production processes is essential. This includes the EUV equipment that is currently exclusively produced by the Dutch-based ASML. Is Huawei whistling in the dark, painting a big picture, or just having an idiot's dream? Or is it just a matter of setting a difficult objective and seeing how close you can get? Or do they already have some certainty, perhaps even already accomplished something? The answer to this question, for those who truly understand the technology, not me by the way, my PhD is in international relations, not semiconductors. I'd love it if you guys stop asking me technical questions, please. I believe that the true experts will have different assessments of Huawei's chip manufacturing capabilities before and after the release of the Mate 60. What do you think? That's all for this episode. Thank you for watching. This program is broadcast on Tuesday every other week. Please subscribe to us, give us a like, share, and hit the notification bell to see our updates right away. Also, leave your comments to let us know your thoughts or any topics you would like to understand. I am Rocky Uriankai. I will see you next time.